build a high-performing culture? This is Culture Architects. Candid conversations with extraordinary leaders sharing their biggest successes, failures, and lessons learned on their culture journeys. Here's David J. Friedman.
So my guest today is Mark Baiada. Mark is the founder and the chairman of Bayada Home Healthcare. So this is an amazing company. Mark started this company back in 1975. We're going to get into the story of how Mark started, which is a fascinating story. But he started this on his own in 1975. He was back in his 20s. He had $16,000 of savings, and he began this home healthcare company. What's remarkable is today, from that early beginning, Bayada now has over 350 offices in 22 states, 8 countries, 26,000 employees. So this is a massive organization. But wait, what may be even more impressive, and we'll get into this in our conversation with Mark, is the commitment that Mark has always had to building an organization with a great culture. And in particular, something that you'll learn about, which Mark calls the Bayada Way. So welcome, Mark. Thanks for joining us. Thrilled to have you on the podcast.
Good. David, thank you very much. Wonderful to be here. And thanks for all you do to support culture within organizations.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's my pleasure. So let's go back just to give people a little bit of the story. So we're going back to 1975. People don't know much about home healthcare. It's not really an industry of note. Mark's in his, you're in your 20s back then and thinking, I'll get into home healthcare. How'd that happen?
Okay. Well, I was in my 20s, but I had been thinking about something like that for a long time. Probably from the time I was a young person, I wanted to do something big. I always had no trouble thinking big. And I specifically started thinking about my own business when I got out of college, but realized I didn't have any money and I didn't have enough experience.
Minor details.
So I started saving like crazy. I turned into quite a frugal person and working hard in the daytime. I was in marketing research work at my job. And the evening I would take courses. I'd read books. I'm really into preparing myself for the business. I didn't know what it was. I guess I remember it was Easter Sunday, 1973. It was in the afternoon. I was working in Manhattan. The sun was coming in the room. It was that morning. And I reviewed my situation. Do I have the money? Do I think I have the experience? I thought, yes. I go, oh my God, I have to go now. So then I said, well, what business do I go into? And I said, well, I just can't go willy-nilly into anything. I have to have some criteria. So to guide me, this the criteria that match up with the goal. So I said, all right, my criteria would be one, something helping others. I want to have a business helping other people. Two, something I can get into for $16,000, right? Three, coast to coast. I was thinking big. I wanted something that the business was naturally expandable so I could service coast to coast. And the other one is, I want to make sure on a generational basis that the demand for the service would continue to grow slowly but surely. So, you know, I didn't want to be like Blockbuster or video rentals, you know, bamboo, lightning fast that dies quickly. I want to be the tall tree in the forest of businesses. So I had to have everything, light, soil conditions, to make sure that this is, you know, I can see a path. Nothing's guaranteed, but I can see a path. So I went out and started, you know, doing my job in the day and researching at night, came from many business, and I came across this new embryonic industry called home healthcare. And it was, and then there were companies that were just starting franchising it. So I started talking to the franchisor. So I thought possibly I would do a franchise, but then I decided not to because that started to go coast to coast with a franchise. Yeah. But I'm learning, but I was open to learning. So I looked at home healthcare. Did it meet the criteria of helping people? Yeah, sure. Families need care. My elderly grandmother lived with us. So two, did it $16,000 make it? About $50,000 in current dollars. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, you can get in for a low cost here. That's why there's so many competitors out there. Kind of like the insurance business, David. Mm-hmm. Next, how about coast to coast? Well, the franchises are all over the country. I talked to 25 in many states, so the need is everywhere. Then I said, well, how do I know this business, the need will continue on a long-term basis? Well, I was a marketing researcher. I like facts and evidence to support decisions. So I went to the library. Well, let's look at the number of elderly. Well, the number of elderly was, it's the prediction of the population, population age is a very stable number. This birth and mortality rates are fairly stable on a long-term basis. So I saw that there's going to be an increase in the number of seniors, especially 85 plus. And even now, I mean, I'm predicting 45 years ago, and now the baby boomers are here, and that's even a little jump up. So that was a solid estimate. Two, will the economy continue to increase to pay for this? It was chugging along 2% a year, 3% a year. The economy doubles every 36 years. So I said, well, that's good. So there's more money. In fact, it's even growing faster than that. And they all continue to grow, right? So next I said, coast to coast, who traditionally takes care of the seniors? Mm-hmm. Women. Chart, women in the workforce is increasing, not available. Size of families going down, right? Lack of caregivers. Yeah. Geographic dispersion, they're living across the country. Yeah. So the daughters can't care for their moms anymore. So all these things led to there's going to be an increase in need for professionally paid home health care, right? So people can be at home. Yeah. There's a couple of things I didn't predict, which actually have helped since then, which is technology, people's dislike of hospitalizations, ability to bring skilled care into the home. I was doing personal care and support services. So actually, a couple of things I didn't predict that actually helped. So I decided to do it. I said, oh my God. So I was living in Manhattan. That was too big. I came back to South Jersey. That was like too small. It felt like Goldilocks. Philadelphia seemed just the right size. Uh-huh. So I opened, there's 1.5 million people. Someone must need home health care. So I got my office right at the crossroads of Broad Street and Market Street near the public transportation lines and launched it in January. We incorporated January 17th, 1975. And I was so cheap, I did everything myself. I incorporated myself. I figure I'm not going to pay a lawyer. I don't have any money. I need that money. So I fill out a form and send it to Harrisburg. I even went to the little shop to get the corporate seal where the lawyers go. Mm-hmm. I did all the accounting myself. I did design the logo. I was kind of like a self-help pioneer, you know, landing and you're on a farm, you have to do everything yourself. But I did it to save money because I didn't want my money to run out before I was able to become profitable.
Wow.
So,
So that's back in 1975. You've got this vision of building this great company. You've done this research to verify that the industry you chose is clearly going to be a booming industry for the future and long-term opportunity. So you're in the right industry. What is it that caused you to have a vision of, I'll say it, the type of company? So, you know, which leads us to culture, but somewhere along there, you decided you weren't just going to have a company that was financially successful, but you had a vision for the type of company it was. Where'd that come from?
I don't know. Wanted to make sure that I ruled out certain companies like a gambling company or casino, but that was more of what I didn't, the type of thing I didn't want to do. I wanted to find meaning and purpose to what I was doing. Mm-hmm. And I didn't come from a healthcare family. Mm-hmm. It was more of my dad was in the Navy, had an insurance business. It was more of a commercial business family. Uncle had a trucking company and other. But I guess maybe I look at my life and I have maybe three main influences. Mm-hmm. Is my mother was work hard, be a good person, you know, take care of your family. My father was more learn, know the world, understand the world, and be successful. But I think the day to day, the I went to Catholic school and the nuns probably concern for others, responsibility for the world. Finding probably I got that more from them, although my parents took me to church every Sunday, but I picked up that message. And I'm any messages that are positive, I kind of like glom on. Like you see little, all the things where you get little quotes all the time. I love the quotes. Every one I try to find the best in. So I'm a natural for a virtuous kind of sayings and affirmations. And I just, you know, I kind of, yeah. In fact, I wanted to be a priest when I was younger, but then I discovered girls and I decided that wouldn't be right up my
alley. That's funny. So talk to me about, let's go to the Bayada Way. So how big were you when you decided to formalize the Bayada Way? What was the size of the company at that point?
Oh, over 100 offices. Wow. The reason was when I first started, we didn't have anything written down. We didn't have any culture. We just went to work. But the work we did was the same, very similar to the Bayada Way. Mm-hmm. I mean, you tune in and care about people because you care about them. You have a responsibility. You're going to do the excellent work and you're going to show up every day. Compassion, excellence, reliability, the three main virtues of the Bayada Way. So, at one point I go, well, we can't keep growing by word of mouth here and personal relationships. And we have to have formalized. So we have it written down what we stand for. Mm-hmm. So, you know, anything that lasts a long time, organizations that last a long time usually have a written statement, written values, something that they glom onto, such as the United States Constitution, the Bible, and Johnson & Johnson even has the short credo. Yep. So I decided that would be something that would give some permanence and to our work. And also, remember that movie, Build It and They Will Come?
Yep. Field of Dreams.
Yeah, Field of Dreams. If you say something and put it out there, people who feel the same way will now join.
Yeah.
Because now they're self-selecting in. So by just doing it casually, but formally and broadcasting it, so people join and stay because of a reason. So, but it took about 2 years of two or more years of development to take how we operated and then convert it to the document, the Bayada Way.
So for the benefit of our audience, so from 1975 to Bayada Way started, what year was that? Do you remember?
Bayada started in 1975, January.
And then when did you create the Bayada Way?
The Bayada Way was completed the fall of 2005.
Okay. So for 30 years, from 75 to 2005, you're running this company, you're opening offices, you're now up to 100 offices from that first one. And there's a way you're doing things, but if I'm hearing you right, it's intuitive, it's the way we are, it's part of our personalities, but it's not documented in any way.
Exactly. It's how we respond to clients' needs, how we take care of our employee, because every day is a discussion about those things. So it's just how we were approaching them. And then as we had more offices, I'm now one person, two people away from the people doing the work. So then kind of like anything, you throw a stone in the water, the ripples start to go as you go farther away. So I needed a way to make it consistent and amplify it.
You know, it's interesting because that transition that you're describing, Mark, is one that I certainly see in all the work that we've done with companies, that most of the people we work with are people who, like you, intuitively have had a good culture because they're leaders who are passionate about their people, about the people they're serving. They've got the right ideas. And just by the force of their leadership, it's worked well. And at some point, a transition takes place. For you, it was, you know, 30 years in, but at some point, transition takes place where the leader says, if I want this to be to perpetuate as we grow, somehow I've got to document this and formalize this and put more structure behind it. So it's not just hoping that people pick it up by osmosis somehow. So yes, that came to you in the early 2000s.
Yeah. And it also had to do with the vision. Mm-hmm. I went coast to coast.
Right.
Well, as time passes, I get bigger vision. So then I went worldwide. And then I even had the bigger one. I want to make something that forms, as we say now, a lasting legacy. So I'm providing an institution of real value to the communities we serve that'll last, like the hospital, the fire department, the universities, rather than a flash in the pan internet company that's flipped out. We want to create something of value. So if people need us, we're there. If people need us, we're there. So that, then I study how companies last a long time, and they usually have something written down. What their purpose is, what their values are, what their vision is, that people then join in. They now, the members now feel they have an obligation to make it continue. This is kind of like a mandate now. So this is intentional to keep the company going a long time.
Got it. So it's a combination then, if I'm hearing you, of the reason to document this is a combination of, one, we're growing and I want to make sure that we stay consistent in the things that we're doing, because Mark can't be everywhere in all places. Two, if I want something to last as a legacy for generations to come, there's got to be some way of codifying what we stand for and what we're about. And that's what caused you to say, all right, it's time to do this.
Yes.
So now you're ready to codify this, the Bayada Way. I remember you and I having lunch a couple times back then at the DoubleTree restaurant near my old office. And talk about, so you are more, I would say you're more, my experience of you is that you're more collaborative. You think bigger, but you're also more collaborative than most leaders. And so let's talk about, all right, how did you go about determining, well, what should be written into the Bayada Way?
It's a very good question. This is an interesting path. So first of all, I wanted to do it, but I needed some help. So I met Dr. Al Friedman, because he's a psychologist, and we were taking care of his son, Jack, who has spinal muscular atrophy, who recently passed, it said. But Jack was only 3 years old at the time. But Al, we hired him to do some in-services for our nurses so they could understand what the families are going through. Most of the day came from a hospital, and home care is different than a hospital. And I attended and I go, oh, this guy gets it. So we started meeting. I said, can you help me write down what we stand for? We said, yes. So at first we said, he'll represent the families. I'll represent the nurses and the caregivers, and we'll quickly write this down. So then we started talking about it. I said, well, this really shouldn't come from us. This really has to come from the clients we serve, their families, in Al's case, the parents, and others, it's the wife or the children, the nurses and the aides who go into the home and do this every day. I mean, this is their life's calling, to go in and help people. And the office, the people, the managers who put it all together. So we kind of like took our own agenda off the table. And then we started, and especially with Al, we started having focus groups. We would have about 10, 12 of like-minded people, nurses, parents, children, aides, office people, about, when home care is working properly, what are the values that are going on? Then we just kept doing reading books about this type of thing, and came up with a book by Dr. Michael Aponner called Managing by Values. And this says values are first. Actually, they're over behaviors. Okay. So values are first, and a company should be run by values. And so it's kind of like being responsible to a higher authority. So most companies think he's in charge, right? Kind of like, probably the Russian view now, right? But no, we're saying no, the values are. So I looked at it as the values over my head that I'm supposed to be responsible to. So we started asking what values are important. We had values list of 50 values, a lot of values you can pick. And O'Connor said, we went to Florida to meet him. You need 3 to 5. You have to get it down to the ones you are. So we had all this conference. We're getting people in their hearts, what they felt about the work, what their families, what they needed from the work. We're trying to get the intersection of need and delivery, right? So then we had overnight retreats. We went to overnight retreats where we had really kind of sessions, like people talking about it, getting into their underlying feelings about this. And it this kind of emerged through all this. So we have multiple drafts then, and it came in various sections. So the mission was basically a mission we had had before. We had this written down before to help people have a safe home life with comfort, independence, and dignity, and more. The values are the ones that kind of clicked. Compassion. If you're not caring, if we're coming to your home, we don't really care about you. We shouldn't be there. So you have to, and the key results are clients and their families feel cared for and supported. That's why we're there. And, but this is work with the spirit, so universal faith, hope, and love. It's spiritual, right? And it's, but it's not, it's not, it's not religiously affiliated, right? Simple things, be respectful, treat others the way they wish to be treated, which is a little flip on the golden rule,
right?
Because everybody's a little bit different because the way, what my needs and others in the same situation, and we have different needs. Mm-hmm. So we have the compassion, but then our compassion is not one we're blazing. We manifest our compassion through the work we do. We do excellent work. We provide home health care to our clients to the highest professional, ethical, and safety standards. So that puts a pretty big responsibility on us. If we really care, we really do good work. And if you really care, you're going to show up every day, which is a very special problem for home health care, but it's one-on-one.
Right.
So a hospital can run the floor without a down a nurse, but a home health care can't without a nurse, but there's no care.
Yeah.
So these are kind of really tailored. And I tell you, we've been doing this for a while. They fit. Mm-hmm. They fit the work we did. They really fit. The next is the vision. That was more me, but everybody went along with it. Mm-hmm. We want to serve millions of people worldwide. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Think big.
We want to maintain a lasting legacy. So we're going to be here in 100 years. Mm-hmm. And we want to be the world's most compassionate and trusted team of home healthcare professionals. Somebody has to be the best at what they do in town. I mean, there's best of everything. Best hoagies, best pizza, mm-hmm. best dry cleaner, more best home healthcare. And it's not, it's almost like we want to, but it's almost a responsibility because we care, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and the last is our beliefs, mm-hmm. which is very interesting because we added this at the end. In the first one is our clients come first. Mm-hmm. So that has a lot of companies say that, but they don't necessarily follow it. So right now we're in, I'll tell you how it applies, which people don't really realize. Right now we're in the middle of a nursing shortage.
Right.
So we're not able to get enough nurses for our clients. So we're talking about, you can look at it in business talk. Oh, we're short. Our supply chain is short. We don't have enough nurses. If we had more nurses, the business would increase. Wouldn't that be great? Well, if you put the clients first, there's some mom last night that stayed up all night because we didn't have a nurse for her. Mm-hmm. So if it was your family, you'd find a nurse somehow. Mm-hmm. So our duty is to find good nurses for our clients. Business takes care of itself. Mm-hmm. Business takes care of itself. So it takes the whole business and gets down our reason for being. It's there to help families have a safe home life with comfort, independence, and dignity. Mm-hmm. And then the next is our employees are our greatest asset. You better take good care of these nurses. Because if you don't take good care of them and have join with them in taking care of the clients. The good news, most nurses put clients first. That's why they became a nurse in the first place.
Right.
So they're more geared toward this than the average manager, which is nice. So they go, sure, that man. The bad way for them is like, that's why I became a nurse. There's no surprises here.
Right.
And so we built these beliefs here. So we have a system, so to speak, which people, the nurses and the staff, they relate to. It's actually worked out pretty well as a good foundation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, your comment I find interesting about putting the patients, the customers, the families first, and that the business will take care of itself. And obviously, that doesn't mean we don't focus on the business, but that if we do that right, the rest will take care of itself. And I had done one of my podcasts I'd done with Horst Schulze, who was the founder and longtime CEO of Ritz Carlton.
Oh, you did.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. I like to listen to that podcast.
Yes, you should. And
how do I get the link?
I'll give the link to that. One of the things that Horst said, and is a strong believer and very similar to you, is if we take care of the customers and we deliver incredible service and we do all the things that we know. They have their basics, their 20 basics, that if we do those things, the business will take care of itself. And he gets frustrated when he hears about young people coming out of business school and they just want to focus on the finances and the operations and all these other things. And he has a very strong point of view and from his experience that take care of the customer, the rest of it will work on its own. And then again, that's not an excuse for not being rigorous about business processes, but it's what's our priority? If we do the job right, the business will grow.
Well, the business processes support taking care of the customer.
Yes.
They're not there to maximize your profit.
Yeah. And yet when we do those things and take care of the customer, we end up maximizing the profit, even though that wasn't the goal itself.
Yeah. So the Bayada Way is on a wallet card. Uh-huh. And I got the idea from him because he has it and all the Ritz-Carlton employees carry it. In fact, I was at a Ritz-Carlton and asked a couple and they pulled it out. So I said, that's great. So now we have our primary method of distribution is wallet cards.
Yeah, which are great.
This was such a great start to our conversation. I'm sure you're going to want to hear more, so stay tuned for part two of our episode with Mark, where he's going to discuss the rituals and behaviors that he created to practice the Bayada Way and his vision for the future of Bayada Home Healthcare.
This has been Culture Architects with David J. Friedman. Join us next time for more insights and wisdom from great leaders in all walks of life. To book David for your next event, or to learn more about his writing, speaking, or consulting, go to davidjfriedman.com. Culture Architects with David J. Friedman is a production of CultureWise.